As stated in the previous video, in 2003, Pride was on an upswing. Although other companies existed and still exist today, some fighters that are world famous today that went to Pride because Pride was picking off a lot of local Japanese talent within its borders. Rings, in the first 4 years, was a pro wrestling company, then became an MMA organization with a number of UWF guys like Kiyoshi Tamura, Masakazu Funaki, Nobuhiro Takada, the face of Pride FC, came from that camp as well. Rings was founded by Akira Maedia, along with others. While in the UWF, he was one of the guys who wanted the company to go with the way of submissions and grappling way back in the early 80s. This was such a heated debate among other members of the UWF and Maedia that in the pro wrestling match between the original Tiger Mask and himself, they went what was called going cement. In the States, this is referred to pulling the trigger, which means using maneuvers to really injure the opponent. Maedia left the UWF and became a star in New Japan Pro Wrestling. This man is responsible for Japan's slightly lesser known rings, which gave the world Fedor, then BTT members Minotaro Nogueira, Babalu, and Arona, as well as the O-Ring brothers. The stables and rings were nationalistic rather than a straight-up camp. Gustafado Machado and Henzo Gracie were in the same stable as the Brazilian top team members I just rattled off, and it also featured Randy Couture and Dan Henderson. Many people remember the rivalry that peaked in Pride and also ended there between Shudobox and Brazilian top team, but few remember that Team Quest's co-head Dan Henderson was in the mix as well. Unfortunately for them, Rings could not keep up with Takada's company. The product was overall about the same, but the production values were shabby compared to Pride, and all of the names that they had would eventually become normal vocabulary for today's MMA fan. None of them were even close to Sakuraba or Vonley making waves in Pride and the Gracie family name as a unit during that time of 2002. Rings really only had Kimura as its major star, who defeated Sakuraba in the UWF. Small tidbit, Kimura was called out for years by Sakuraba, Funaki, and Takada, all one-time UWF stablemates. He fought and beat all of them when they were way past their primes. Rings closed its doors for what everyone thought was the last time in 2002. Its brand, backed by its leader, Akira Maedia, will be back in big ways 3 years later with something to prove. More on that later. Let's focus our attention to what was the power vacuum of Japanese MMA that was making it hard for everyone else. What I don't want to do right now is go through the results of the events. That can be looked up on MMALinker.com, SureDog.com, or Wikipedia. The overarching theme of Pride from late 2002 to 2005 was the belt system and the influx of foreign fighters, mainly in the light heavyweight and heavyweight divisions that was the most rich in talent and worldly known, and that was going to get even more advantageous with Shudo and deep fighters that were key figures in Pride Bushido. Kazuo Musaki, Akihiro Gono, Tetsuya Kawajiri, Maha Sakurai, and Takanori Gomi were all vital in legitimizing Japanese MMA in the years after the former Japanese pro wrestlers were rapidly declining. After losing to Joakim Hansen in Shudo, and then BJ Penn in Rumble on the Rock, Gomi dropped his wrestling game for a stellar knockouts and went on a rampage, making him the go-to man for the Bushido events, putting him up there with Yoshida and Sakuraba in terms of overall fame. It was not just his finishes that made him a star. Having a rivalry with Shudobox lightweights that he went 0-4 against, beating other Japanese fighters in a vicious fashion, all while showboating, and combine that with a pretty hectic fighting schedule, kept him both and the division as a whole exciting and visible because Gomi's weaknesses were apparent even then. But for a few years, no one could really expose them. The UFC's answer to Gomi was Sean Sherk, someone notorious for not finishing fights. BJ Penn would be coming back in 2005, but the UFC lightweight title contention really didn't get interesting until he lost in 2010 after nearly a year layoff from the welterweight fight with George St. Pierre in 2009. Enough about the small guys. Let's talk about the big fighters of Pride FC. It wasn't until 2012 in the UFC that a better set of heavyweights were under one banner. The Holy Trinity was Fedor, Minotaro Nogueira, and Krokop. But guys like Sergey, Josh Barnett, Kevin Randleman, Mark Hunt, and Fedor's little brother Alexander Emelianenko were all in the mix keeping things interesting. Something that was true for MMA worldwide in the early days of weight classes was that the heavyweight division was plagued with fights that involved two big men that were one to two dimensions, at best using more strength than skill. No successful organization on an international scale has ever lasted without a light heavyweight division, and Pride had that in spades. Finally, Silva's dominant reign lasted for years, but the contenders were all dangerous as well. Grand Prix are coming more and more frequent, something I really enjoyed because it took the basic martial arts tournament approach to matchmaking and leaving freak show fights with minimal man versus a large man somewhere in the mid-card to entertain those not-so-hardcore MMA fans, which is better than two guys that have no names that are going nowhere. Now, it was not until I looked back at the information before I realized how good Pride tournament system bracket was going until I saw Dreamin' and Goku. Pride would have at least one opening round match between two guys that would likely take the whole thing if they weren't facing one another. Two actually square off against each other in the opening round. In a later part, I'll explain why not doing that can go horribly wrong. What Pride did that I never really liked was having all the fights that involved champions, but without actually having the belt on the line. Since the first Grand Prix in 2000, all the winners got a gold belt. However, the weight divisional belts were silver, and no, silver is not worth more than gold in Japan. The idea was that a true champion is the one who defeats multiple opponents in one night. That I understand. But all those Wanderlei Silva, Takanori Gomi, Fedor Emelianenko fights without their belts on the line, and sometimes not even in the main event, was definitely counterintuitive. K1 itself was the biggest fighting league in the world at the time, but it was beat by Pride for the New Year's Eve show in 2005. Unlike America, New Year's Eve is more of a family holiday rather than a big party, so more people are in their homes in Japan. The success that Dream Stage had with Shockwave 2005 had nothing to do with luck. This was a card that had all the big names and important fights, except Fedor, and lived to the hype. The lightweight Grand Prix had two Japanese fighters, Gomi and Sakurai, former teammates and kind of a passing of the torch. The middleweight Grand Prix was Bustamante versus Dan Henderson. The Shooto Box Brazilian top team rivalry hit its crescendo with Ricardo Rona versus Wanderlei Silva II. And this was headlined by the biggest purse in MMA to date at $2 million each with renowned judokas Naoya Ogawa versus Yoshida. I urge all of you to watch Shockwave 2005. Akira Maedia was still pissed that the success of Pride killed off his company Rings. He tried his hand again in the MMA market. They say copying is the greatest form of flattery. This is not the best analogy for the starter brand K1 Heroes in 2005, but it's close enough. Heroes tried to out-Pride Pride. Super elaborate entrances by guys like Kid Yamamoto, Yoshihiro Akiyama, and Genki Sudo, combined with just some plain old uneven matchmaking, made K1 Heroes entertaining superficially, but overall unremarkable. Allow me to explain. The first 8 events averaged between 10 to 12 matches. There were a total of 89 fights from March 2005 to March 2007. 69 of those fights ended in a finish, 40 by way of knockout or technical knockout, and 29 by submission. When you watch it, it is entertaining, but knowledgeable fans knew that most of what they saw was just mismatches, especially with the UFC getting bigger and less Tito Shamrock-ish, and Pride being as legit as it was going to get. That will be the subject of part 4, the downfall of the Giant, the UFC buyout, and the startups of Sengoku and Dream. Please subscribe, share with your friends, and anyone who loves Japanese MMA, feel free to comment. Take care.